Hey guys, we're starting.
I'm sorry.
We're gonna start with the government transition team update.
Hey guys,
we'll start through the government's transition update, CIP. Thank Megan, we'll talk through. You and Chief Gandy have a few things y'all to talk through, and then we'll go to the next session. So we're ready to start with the government's transition.
I'll just stand over here and project, so if you cannot hear me, just say the word, and I'll try to be louder. I'll come over here. All right, so now that the city's governance transition committee has issued its recommendation, we wanted to take a little time to discuss the procedures and the recommendations a little more in depth. And so tonight, we're going to review briefly the governance team's written report, which will be published on the city's website soon. We have a couple of committee members who are here to take any questions that you have and talk with you a little bit more in depth about how they reached their conclusion, if you would like that. And then I will take over and then go through the legal procedures as the final part of the presentation, just so we can briefly outline the procedures that the city will need to go through in order to make this change. And with that, I'd like to put these governance team recommendations up on the slide and hand it over to Mr. Jim Hall, who is here to speak on the committee's behalf.
Mayor, members of the council, I know Mike Oliver did a very thorough briefing 2-3 weeks ago. I was watching it on YouTube. But on behalf of the committee, we stand by our recommendations, and I know that Megan has provided you a read-ahead copy. So I think, I am available right now to really answer any questions or provide you any input into anything that wasn't covered as thoroughly as you may have liked in our written report.
The question on the appointment, I guess, of the city manager. Obviously, the whole process to get this through, if this is something that they want to do, and then everybody's got to vote. What was the thought process or any information on, like, you had a city manager? They're being appointed for how long? Three appointments every 4 years.
They serve at will for as long as the mayor and council feel they're doing a good enough job. And absolutely, Megan, correct me if I'm wrong, but there is no term limit. And one of the benefits of having that city manager would be that continuity. Yeah.
Or are they appointed? They're kind of like a fire chief, police chief, things like that. That deal. Essentially, every 4 years, that governing body appoints them or reappoints them.
I don't believe they go through a reappointment cycle. I do believe that they are in position until the council and the mayor decide that it's time for a change.
That's correct.
But it's not a 4-year contract, I believe, but it's not a 4-year.
They serve at will.
We spoke to many city managers, many of the ones that are serving in Alabama, and many of them have been there for 20-some years, some of them 5 years, but...
That's called my average. Is there an average, is there an average length on all of, I guess?
There might be if you did some research, but I don't know what the average length is, but I do believe the attempt would be that they come in, they're vetted really hard, and you hire the right person, and they are, they are a longstanding member of the city, regardless of the administration changes, all through the mayor and council.
So, did y'all do any kind of like a third comment, like teach y'all, like what are the pros of hiring a manager and what are the cons?
Yeah, absolutely.
What are the major pros, what are the major cons?
Well, I think the pros might Mike Oliver in his presentation broke it out. I think our written report really does focus on the pros. There were not a ton of cons for the city manager form of government. And Arthur, jump in. Jump in if you think of anything. But I think, you know, where you start with the cons would be, and we heard some horror stories of getting the wrong person. If you have an individual in that is not a right fit for the culture, strategy, and direction, that could absolutely be a con. To mitigate that con is the fact that a city manager can be removed because, again, they're at-will employees if they're not following the strategy and direction, because all of the legislative power still resides within the elected body of the city, and their function is to execute that vision and legislative, you know, aim points on a daily basis and really just run the administrative side of the city. So, you know, that was the biggest con. And then as far as the staggered terms, you know, cost was obviously probably the biggest con for that. As you know, it wasn't unanimous with the board. And I think the driving factor for the split board was there was a couple of members of our committee that felt like maybe the cost didn't, you know, set with the overall benefit. There, you know, the other con for staggered terms was the fact that there's a, you know, potential for lower voter turnout. I don't think that really drove any decision making within the The pros, obviously, continuity, professionalism. It provides a avenue for the mayor to focus on the strategy, direction, and overall vision of the city, working hand in hand and collaboratively with the council, wherein you've got a professional, credentialed, you know, city manager who really is running the day-to-day operations. It frees the mayor up to really focus on the outreach and the strategy and the vision of the, you know, and the will of the people, I guess you could say.
Yes, yeah. Just to not really just a bit more of what James said, regarding cons, as he indicated, there were nothing that stood out. However, the one key element that continued to highlight itself regarding the city manager role was the theme of leadership. So that seemed to be the constant in regards to identifying an individual to serve that role, what's the type of leadership that individual will bring. So if there are any areas of cons, it would be assessing and evaluating extremely closely what type of leadership approach or principle that individual will bring.
You couldn't have a city, you do not want to have a city manager that is trying to compete with the mayor for authorities and power. You know, you really need a city manager who is focused on the day-to-day operations of the city and understanding that scope. And I think, like Arthur said, you get a city manager that wants to exert more of a leadership role outside of the scope that's appropriate, you know, that there are horror stories.
Is essentially, I'm trying to think of functionally, you know, I mean, the liberal arrival, who hires you, who fires you. So what it sounds like, I'm just trying to understand it, is the new council form of government, if we went that way, would have six council reps, the mayor would be a voting member now. That governing body would appoint this individual to this position. That individual would now be reporting functionally to that governing body, and that governing body essentially yearly, whenever, would be responsible for reviewing that individual's performance and deciding whether or not they retain them or not. And that governing body solely would be the body that could remove or remove or, you know, whatever.
100%.
Okay. And so it would not be an individual that reports to council or an individual report to the mayor, but it's an individual report to that governing body.
Absolutely.
Which is both.
It is both. And, you know, the fact of the matter is, you know, you hear some rumblings that say, people say, well, if you get a city manager, you're taking away the voice of the people. You know, I've heard that said, and I would counter emphatically that you absolutely do not, because, again, really the power and authority never leaves the city council and the mayor. In our case, it would change the way you do business, with the mayor being the president of the council and a voting member. But other than that fact, you know, there is absolutely no circumstance where this individual would be pulling power away from the folks that are voted on by the citizens of Madison. You know, it would probably be handled like any other city hiring action, but, you know, you would post it, you would have to probably work together to come up with the job details and the description, and then it would be advertised and competed. But I am probably not a subject matter expert on the city of Madison hiring priorities, but, you know, the one thing I can tell you is there are avenues and other cities that could help you tailor up the proper requirements and prerequisites. And there are cities in Alabama that could help you get the right, you know, information into the job listing to get the right person. So, and then, you know, I do believe that you all would be part of the hiring process. I believe you guys would be the hiring process.
Well, it would be the 2025
capsule,
whatever happens.
Right.
A couple of things. One, the report that the governance committee has put in place will be on the website tomorrow, so just make sure everybody knows we'll add that and make the PowerPoints onto the website. Yes, that's who would hire them. And most likely what we would do as a city would have two or three council folks on, along with HR, on the initial search committee. So it goes through HR, you do a nationwide search, same as police or fire chief. They narrow that down, they get it to a reasonable number that small committee can review. That committee would most likely bring again, like we do, you know, 3 to 5 qualified applicants to the full council, who in turn would interview them and then make the vote to hire.
And I didn't say it up front, but I just wanted, you know, foot stomp a little bit. This committee that was formed, this is a recommendation. You know, this is our recommendation to the city. And moving forward, it is still 100% up to Mayor Finley and the city council to decide if this is the direction you want to go. We were not given any authority. I want to make that clear. We were just given the ability to come together and put together a recommendation for
y'all. Yeah, and one other note is to include our current city leaders here when we solicited their feedback. The recommendation was specifically data driven, so that's how we reached the conclusion of making that recommendation. It's really data. Based on the data that we received.
The committee had no political agenda. We literally looked at this from what is best with the, you know, growth, both now and anticipated growth, and where we need to go as a city.
And when it comes to letting the person go with the majority, how does that work?
That would be laid out in a contract with the city. And so that would just be to be
up to the governing body to figure that out, or is that a...
Yeah.
hard job. Councilwoman Benzie, we looked at like the Alabama law, and I don't believe the law is even that specific. I do believe you guys would set that up and do that contract on how that works, whether it's majority, got to be unanimous, whatever the case may be. I think that would be a decision that all that
matters.
Okay, as we started out, or as progressive council comes in.
So I think we would set the standard, and then I'll be in the council and do whatever they're going to do, and they're going to work. We set the standard.
The next set submission, and I hear people, and it doesn't have to be here, whatever you voted on by the citizens of Madison.
So hold on to the process, because Megan's getting ready to get in the process in a second. So that's a great, you know, we want that defined, we want our community to know how this will move forward. And I think you have, most likely will be the council vote. I think one of the things that I asked a question on as they presented this back was in 2015, they basically had three different options, which was keep the way it is, do a mayor, seven council members, and a city manager, or do a voting mayor, six council members, and a city manager. So why, when you guys really looked at that middle option of, or at least it wasn't initially was, why aren't we looking at a mayor, seven council members, and a city manager? And in essence, what I heard the committee say, you guys correct me if I'm wrong, is that looking at that, it almost gave you two against one in some form or fashion. You could have a council that puts somebody in, but the mayor kind of run on an autonomous platform, and all of a sudden, now this person and this person are fighting, because they have two against one. The way it works now is the seven voting members, including the mayor, are the ones who put that city manager in place and use the words that are in direct correlation to being the right person to accomplish what that collective body was elected to do. And were something not happening with that city manager, the collective body that put it in, the seven members, you would have a majority vote if they decided that that needed to be changed.
It's about having an odd number.
Yeah.
Counting the mayor as voting member.
Kind of having those seven members put that person in place to help them manage the city. And if that needs to change, it would change because, you know, again, well, 4 years from now, the city manager is supporting that council to accomplish certain things, and a different council and mayor come in, they probably came in because direction wasn't going the way they wanted it to, and they may look to put a different person in that place. They turn right around and make the exact opposite. City's going great, we have to turn over to somebody who doesn't want to run. We want to keep them in place because they're accomplishing what they're wanting.
And then you want to build staggered elections. But since the state was so generous and extended our term for it,
that's
not
the word I'm thinking of.
Out to 2025. So if I do the math right, if I remember my basic civics, that essentially puts every single one of our elections, municipal elections, on out. There is no state, there is no federal, so we're the only ones drawn through the ballots, you know, we're a blockbuster. So doing that, I mean, yeah, we significantly risk to put additional money up to do those elections, and even on a non-presidential year, or even presidential year, we have still abysmal turnouts, 25% of what we left. So are we like our opponents? Do we really think the juice is worth the squeeze in doing that? I understand y'all's recommendations, but I mean, really trying to get the people out. I mean, we can't control our turnout, but when you know the statistics, is the juice worth the squeeze in that? I mean, I pose that question, but I mean, if you're going to get 5% turnout, I think roughly the number is about 5,000 per voting location. Our election, and you got seven. So,
I have a lot of
concerns
about
issue.
Not so much because you that the neighborhood run, you can put in more interest.
Sure.
And then, and that off there, whatever, who's really going to be, you know, are there going to be groups that are going to have an opportunity? Is it going to have any near the same kind of traction as the neighborhood? So, that would be my concern between the split.
And the two main towns, like I mentioned, were the fact that there is a cost involved with that extra cycle. board of elections, and the fact that there is, you know, historical data that shows high propensity for a lower voter turnout. And again, you know, the way I can describe it from the committee is the vote was 4-2 in favor of the staggered elections, but the folks that were in favor said they were like at 60%, and the folks that were opposed were at like 60%. So this was not a landslide by any stretch. And I believe that it is now your role to debate the pros and cons and make a decision that you see best suited for Madison.
Do we know statistically in an election what the turnover rate is in council and mayor? I mean, I think at least from the left side, it's generally no more than 50%.
I think the city was not published. I think I've seen.
That would be nice to say that just over the history. Have we ever seen the religious?
Well, we should be on the first term. It was you, Mara, Greg, and Teddy. We're all me.
Yeah, and then four is last time.
No,
three.
Three. So, I mean.
So, 4 out of 7 is better
than 50%. Yeah. But at the same time, are you here? Well, no, because you get 4 out of 8. You got 8 of us elected, 7 council, 1 mayor. So I'm thinking that body, right? So in other words, are we in doing that? Are we really fixing something, or are we just creating an illusion that we're fixing a problem that doesn't exist? Do the statistics really show that we have a problem? Are we, I mean, the potential is there.
And if we grow, is that potential going to be the problem is bigger?
Because
of
the magnitude. Yeah.
And
but, I mean, well, what the data collected reflected that that particular change offer a degree of continuity for sustaining sustainability of what's currently in process.
Yeah.
That probably was a standout feature based on the data that supported the recommendation,
I'll just agree with that. I think the backbone behind that is there's a concern or a perceived risk that there's turnover and you lose that continuity. But is that concern really valid? Is it really rooted in data that there is a legitimate concern?
Right.
Let's see what the data says.
Consider
the
fact that an election costs
about $30,000. Okay, sorry.
So, when you're looking at the city budget as a whole.
Oh, as a whole, that's a dropping
budget. So, is the risk of having a complete turnover of mayor and council worth $35,000?
Yeah, but is it a real risk or is it a word deed? There's a difference. A word deed is, man, I really think this is going to happen, but the likelihood of that. There's a likelihood and the impact, and what I'm hearing is we don't have the data to really understand, is the likelihood of 1 or is it a 5? And I think that I'd like to see that data that says where is that on the likelihood. Because if it's just a 1-1, you know, then from a risk standpoint, it's like, yeah, that's a word. I'm not really worried about that. And
we can paint it that way.
Yeah.
We're about a long way down what that looks like.
Yeah.
I mean, the most experience each of us had other than the mayor is 5 years. So you compare it to Huntsville, where Councilman McLean has been in since 1988, I think that's a different ballgame. Most of us, 5 years.
You know, part of our discussion on the board as we did our interviews and we analyzed this, one of the things we understood was if you become a new city council person in the city of Madison, you also come in with quite a big learning curve. And I bet you, you know, without polling you, that every one of you would say that there was a certain amount of time that took you to you really felt like your feet were on the ground. Part of the pros with this staggered terms is, like, Arthur said, you've got that continuity will always be in place during the election cycles, you know, to make sure that, you know, you've got that steady hand at the wheel, because elections are turbulent, and with the whole team running for election at the same time, there's a lot of turbulence. And one of the thoughts was, you know, if everybody's focused on re-election, are there things slipping through the cracks? Well, the staggered terms would eliminate that. So again, I don't disagree with anything you've said. I can tell you that it's one of those tough issues. And again, there's probably a reason it wasn't unanimous with our committee, because again, you know, it's hard. You've got to analyze what are the pros, what are the cons, and figure out which direction makes sense to move forward.
Well, also, if you're looking at a staggered, and you're thinking, people, I want these people out, well, they can only, if it's an off year, they can only take out three, so it's still be four.
Well, council wants
it. Council wants it. So it would be really hard to live, I mean, if it was truly an uprising of people saying all of them should go, you know, I'm not saying that happens, but if we're staggered and it's harder for the people, because you can always vote in your district.
Right.
I mean, it's not like you can say, well, I don't like what somebody else is doing, and you only have your choice in your district.
Also, along the continuity of that, the question within on the staggered terms, the continuity, if you go to a what they're talking about with the city manager, the continuity is you have seven people who are elected at the same time. If you don't go staggered, those seven people could be city manager, and then you go forward for 4 years. If you go to staggered terms, basically, whoever's on the off years of the mayor, they can use that to their advantage. They've got a free shot running for mayor, you know, and in turn trying to change up in midstream what that collective body has set forth, which could cause some pain as far as the continuity that you're looking for. You know, you all of a sudden change up, you know, if you're saying three council folks, now, well, we didn't like that city manager, so we're changing that in midstream versus right now if you have everybody running at the same time. Kind of, while you don't have that stagger, you had experience, you have the continuity for 4 years, and then your city manager's still in place until that council will decide that they want something to change.
But if you voted in, there's three people, and you still have a majority of the four in place, if it's majority of the city manager, he would still be there.
Right. Unless they decided they didn't want him.
Unless
there's
only four.
I'm just saying, there's a whole lot of scenarios. Yes.
Exactly right.
Can I ask if you had considered that we don't have to make the decision on staggered terms until we hear from the citizens on the city manager? Like, that's a key piece of information we are missing before making a decision on staggered terms. Part of the reason for staggered terms is continuity. So if you, let's say, vote people as they want to, that sort of is a different factor that you have now, you know, versus what if they vote no, we don't want a city manager. Then we don't have to decide the staggered term right now. Before we hear.
We made a recommendation.
Is that
all it's all it is. We made a recommendation.
You can do one or the other,
you can do none.
Yeah, it's a different process in terms of how you build a staggered terms and how you get a city manager.
Absolutely.
So we don't have to decide
to
listen to people and what they're saying. But when it comes to the ballot, it would all be moving on there, right? No.
Their terms is just up to us. It's just us. Where the city manager and the people get to vote. You can do one or the other, or you can do both,
and you do none. But there's a process for both.
No, we don't necessarily have to have a decision on staggered terms at the time discussing whether.
No, these are two separate issues.
You mentioned something about credentials. Could you talk a little bit more? I know you looked at other cities that had effective city managers. You're not talking about just hiring your butt, right? You're talking, there are certain criteria, certain things they study, certain
every city does, you know, hires who they end up wanting to hire. But there are certifications, national level certifications, that most of the city managers we talk to, you know, we're very high on, you know, the actual medical credentials. There are, you know, college programs. There are different backgrounds that, really like public administration realm that would suit you for this type of role. Obviously, experience, if you were maybe a deputy city manager in a bigger city, you know, all those things are the things that would be worth considering. You know, one horror story we heard a city hired a former military installation garrison commander, and the guy came in with really great credentials and wanted to run the city like the U.S. military, and he lasted less than a year. And they just, they said, listen, your, you know, culture that you're bringing is not the culture that we want. So, and that was one of the, you know, horror type stories we heard. I won't say horror stories, but they didn't work out. So,
when we set up the 6 a.m. PT for council.
But I will tell you, I do absolutely, the committee believes absolutely there are great credentials out there, and we think that if you went forward with this and the city citizens voted for this, I do believe that the process would allow you to pick the best qualified person.
Every person that we interviewed, the two big top things was leadership and management skills were the two number one top priority. Because you want to be able to have someone that's going to know how to manage. But then you also want someone to have great leadership skills.
And a collaborator, yes. Not a dictator.
Yeah. Who wants me to manage a team and not have a team manage them? So those were very, very important.
Back to your question, though. They are separate issues. Did I answer that?
Yes.
Did you get
yes.
Okay. Yeah. So they're not all tied together. So.
Also, in your presentation, you talked about the mayor's name as the CEO, and then the CEO. How did you delineate exactly what the role would be? Start to be most clear and how you know the law? Is that part of it?
I will stand by what was written in the report. It was anecdotal. Obviously, that was just an example. That is not formal, you know, COO or whatever. That was trying to give an example of how the relationship played out.
Okay, so that would be something that we could work on.
Yes,
and that's just.
Will either, when the time comes to move forward, mm-hmm. redistrict for 7 or 6. Mm-hmm. Once.
Is there a time frame that that has to be done for the next election?
Yeah. We've got a little more time.
For the next election.
Any other questions?
I've got one that might be more from the mayor than me, but one of the questions that I've heard just out about. Why do we need one? What is it about the job that is facing the Madison administration that would require us to add another top level executive? Maybe it's better to understand how you would see the roles delineated. What would the mayor be doing?
It's growth, softball. You know, it's growth. It's anticipated
growth. Yeah, it really is just managing the sheer. Managing now, if we come look at my whiteboard and then go look at Steve's whiteboard and combine them, and that's what we're managing right now, you know, in that office. As we add more personnel, we have personnel pieces that need to be taken care of. Many times we can't get to, we're not as proactive as we wish we were because we're many times tactically accomplishing things instead of strategically planning things.
So, as I see this problem, it's my responsibility. And again, while I feel like we're doing a good job of it, I feel like as the city grows, it's an opportunity to make a change to the purpose in the best possible position.
So what would you be able to do if we had a city manager if you're not as easily able to do that?
I could get out more, go to a lot of events, a couple of pieces. Alabama Department of Transportation, we see them a lot more than we have in us. We're coming to big projects. Every time we can close a project more quickly, it probably saves us $100,000 to $200,000, to deal with that. Work with other municipalities and entities, the best practices to learn what's going on. There's just a lot of different factors that I wish we could get to and do more of that many times we just can't because we're tactically taking care of things. On the other side, HR, right now in the Huntsville case, John Hamilton manages a lot of the HR pieces, and Tommy does a lot of what we're talking about. But if you can go to DC and meet with legislators, then in turn, meet with the folks out of Montgomery, we do it, but I don't think we do it at the level that we probably could or should. Especially when city grows to the size that it is.
We give you an example, that we got this from other folks. If we maintain the current form of government, just think about this scenario. Somebody gets elected mayor who's, popular, runs a great campaign, and maybe great on social media, great television ads. They become the mayor of Madison. And let's just say that individual has, let's say, no college education, no background in city administration or leadership or any of the skills that maybe you see on a day-to-day basis with Mayor Finley. Well, one of the things the committee considered was 10 years ago, you could get away with that in Madison because it was small, it was still growing, and, but if you look at where we are heading on a trajectory, that scenario could absolutely happen. And that mayor I'm describing may be the perfect mayor for the role as long as you've got that city administrator who's in the trenches making sure that everything that needs to happen within the city is happening so that wildly popular mayor can go out and, focus strategically. But that could happen. 10 years ago, again, we could probably get away with it. It'd be a lot harder in today's environment and over the next 20 years. So,
along those same lines, people ask me, "Isn't Steve the same thing as?" And I go, "Well, people don't report to me. Heads don't report to me. But would there be a way to change some of the responsibilities of the assistant, or have more than one?" An office of assistance or something like that that can take on more of the load, which would be a mayor time, to go out and do that without actually changing the money. Would that be a possibility?
Yes. It's a possibility,
but I think you lose, unless you make some significant changes, that you lose what we talked about earlier is that individual doesn't report to the mayor and they don't report to the council. They report to that governing body that consists of public. Whereas you do that with what you're talking about there, that individual reports to the mayor, and then, thank goodness we got a good mayor and a good administrative assistant and a state executive assistant. But if you don't, then you can have, possibly revenue.
The mayor selects that person, right? So what if the mayor, again, that person I described, that mayor wins election and brings along their high school buddy and says, "You're the new city administrator."
Yeah.
And that person doesn't have any background experience and is running roads. I think my counter to all that discussion is you really professionalize how this city is run. And I think it comes out very clearly in our report. Then the city is being run like a business, which is good for the citizens, it's good for the taxpayers, and it's good for the day-to-day operations. And I think your department heads you know, would probably agree that it provides them the stability and continuity to, you know, handle their role and not have to feel like they've got to answer to a whole lot of different people. You know, so I think from a day-to-day standpoint, that provides, you know, a lot more bandwidth for the mayor to do legislative type activities that make a difference for the city and probably get up and out more than you do already.
The feedback from the department heads was positive for the city manager and the state politics out of that. Can you talk a little bit about the feedback from them?
We're definitely not going to go into the fire chief told us this.
Oh, no, no,
you
no,
know,
no,
but
they were receptive.
But yeah, absolutely. And we did not take a vote, but based on the discussion, I believe it was predominantly favorable direction.
It was. It would be devastating for them if all of us were voted out at one time and they got a group of six or seven or eight new people and had to start over.
Well, I'll say yes and no, because our department heads are fabulous. I mean, you know, you can say we're managing in almost every instance, they are doing a yeoman's job, especially for a city our size. Mm-hmm. So it's devastating.
Well, they have to explain everything to all the people that have history. That's what I'm talking about.
And I will tell you that from a committee standpoint, at no time was this ever an indictment against Mayor Finley or anything that is being done by this legislative body as well as your city department heads. Our focus really was on the future, and I guess it's tough for you as, you know, more of an engineer mind, but you know that hypothetical, there's a lot of hypotheticals out there, and so a lot of our direction was based on you know our best recommendation based on potential growth and what that could drive going forward.
All I can say is a lot of people are concerned that that person is not an elected official, yet they are running our city.
They're not running our city, they're running.
That's the perception, because they are actually going to get it. So I'm just relaying their information.
And while we're throwing in a few things that I've heard, no idea how Facebook would work. The mayor, you know, what just happens to the mayor's salary? I don't feel like we're doing less. I feel we're going to do other things to make a bigger difference strategically. But how that would work as far as you have the city manager. The city manager is going to cost you some money. I have this perspective, a lot of you, when I came to the office in 2008, the mayor's salary was below every department head before. When I left in 2012, one of the things I asked was, please raise the salary, because it is a pretty substantial job they did, and I appreciate that. But to get a city manager, the quality we're talking about is would be the highest paid person probably in the city.
That kind of makes sense.
That was a point of emphasis during our gut election as well.
Yeah.
But just to reinforce, all the authorities of the elected by the citizens reside within the city council and the mayor. And that city manager works for you, would work for you or this body. And so that would be my counter to the folks that say, oh, they're taking away the power and everything else. We heard it too, trust me. And I think collectively we emphatically disagree. We believe that there's no loss of power for you all. I think it provides an opportunity to even better.
Isn't it counter that that's intentional, that you don't want that person to be politically
I think our report is very clear.
School board
completely eliminate politics from this person's.
I mean, and in Madison, I'm glad we appoint our superintendent, and that person doesn't have to stand for election for a political issue versus who's the most
popular. And our school board, who right now is making the best decisions they possibly can. I can tell you I received three emails over the weekend. All three of them, when it came to our children in our schools, were asking for a different thing for us to step in. You know, the collective school board and superintendent, because they're appointed, don't have to worry about being booted out and making the best possible decision they can without political ramifications. So I hear the
conservative people have because they elected to step away. But in the same sense, you guys are the ones that are going to be one of the biggest decisions you make when you come into office as a council and mayor. Who you put in there, it'll be a responsibility, your responsibility as council and mayor.
I'm just asking a bunch of questions.
Oh, no, I think it's a great question. We'll transition over to negative on how to make it work.
Thank you, sir.
Can I get you some?
Ma'am?
I know you're not supposed to speak out here, but can I give you some issue?
Can we get through Megan and then you get some?
Okay.
Hey, guys, first thing is, there's three of the six that are here. We can't tell you how much we put an enormous amount of time in. Thank you guys for everything that you do. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. All right, so the next question stemming from this conversation is, how do we get from here to there? There are several different legal pathways that the city would need to follow in order to make this transition to a council manager form of government, consider whether to have staggered terms, and then also redistrict for six districts instead of seven if it's the will of Madison residents to move forward. I'll just go through the procedures in the Council Manager Act first. The Council Manager Act of 1982 in the state code is the guide for how the city transitions to this form of government and also for how it operates going forward if the city makes this move. It starts with a petition of residents to request this change. Then it moves on to a special election. During that time, the city would need to evaluate what six districts look like instead of seven as part of the redistricting process, and I'll talk about that in a little bit more depth later. Then the city will actually hold a special election if it's called, and if the residents want to move forward, then the city will just enter into a transition period to be ready to have this form of government ready to go in 2025, which is the next general municipal election. If the voters of Madison turn it down, then the city would just have to, you know, take stock of how it wants to move forward, and then it could not attempt to transition to the council manager form of government under this act for at least another 2 years.
Megan, I have a question.
Oh, yes.
If it is a yes, mm-hmm. and you're prepared to transition, would that mean that this council and mayor could hire a city manager to shadow this current mayor and learn, you know, and be ready for the next council or mayor to come on?
Yes, we could absolutely consider that because the state code, as we talked about a little bit earlier, does provide for council to appoint someone by ordinance. The reason that the committee did not recommend that pass permanently is that that role is legally defined to have the same role as the mayor. But if you're already heading into this, you know, time where you know that the council, the city manager has specific roles under the Council Manager Act, you absolutely would have the freedom to make that evaluation during that transition period.
So it's an option, but it's not, you don't have to.
That's correct.
Correct. Okay. Thank you. Would
you think the special election would be held in 2025 or would it be before that?
It would need to be before then. So, and I'll go into a little bit more detail on that procedure now. It's important to note, and the committee really wanted to emphasize this point, the transition to the council and manager form of government starts with the citizens of Madison, and it can only happen with their consent. So they just wanted to be very clear about that. The whole process starts off with a petition of people signing up to say, yes, we would like to consider this form of government on a citywide basis. Once you get to about 900 signatures, which is the number that's 10% of the Madison voters from the last election, that's the number that the city would need to get to under the law, that petition would go to the probate judge's office, and you would evaluate the signatures that are there and make sure everything is verified. And then he would send that petition back to the mayor's office and say it's time to call a special election. At that point, the mayor would be required to call a special election, and that would have to happen no later than 90 days out from the time that petition lands on his desk. Then the city would hold the election, and then the mayor would transmit the results to the governor's office, yay or nay. Does anybody have questions about this before we move on to talking
without staggered terms?
Sort of a specified timeline from Mayor calling for election, election having to be held. Is there a specified timeline or time frame from step one to two and two to three? And
there's no timeline for signatures on the petition.
No, not that. Okay. Once you have 900, there's a probate that has a certain amount of time, and so you have a certain amount of time to notify you because of.
Yeah, he only has about a couple of weeks. It's like 10 to 15 days for each of those parts of the process.
Would they be able to send out cards to every registered voter, even if they hadn't voted? As long as they were registered to vote, you could send out a card that says there's going to be a special election. Are we able to do something like that?
I'm not sure how it works. I mean, I'm sure we could get the word out in various ways, but and that's one method that we can consider in coordination with the city clerk's office.
Does it have to be, is this majority rule?
Yes, it's a majority of the voters who vote and turn out for that election. All right. So next, we'll talk a little bit about the legislative process for requesting that the city get a staggered term schedule. And this is something that the city would have to request from the state legislature. So if the city decides to initiate this request, and it doesn't have to happen in any particular time frame, the only key point is that it would have to be, any staggered terms would have to be set at least 4 months in advance of the next election in 2025. But if the city decides to move forward on this, the city can approach the state legislature, ask for an amendment to the portion of the state code that provides that some cities can have staggered elections, and just add Madison to that. And then, of course, the legislature would consider it and perhaps send it to the governor's desk. During this time, the city council, and then after that, the city council would consider. After the legislature and the governor make their decision, then the issue would come back before the city council to adopt that ordinance. So the legislature can provide this permission for the city to have staggered terms, but that doesn't mean that the city has to. This ultimate decision does reside with the city council, and the council would decide that by an ordinance. 2025 would be the earliest possible election with staggered terms. And the way the terms would work is that the even-numbered council district seats and the mayor would be elected for a 4-year term to start, and then the odd-numbered seats would be elected for a 2-year term to start. So you would have a 2025 election for everybody, and then for the odd-numbered council district seats, you would have another election in 2027, and then they would be elected four-year terms, and then from that point forward, the terms would be staggered. Any question about staggered terms before we move on? Okay. The other process that the city needs to consider in this whole package of decisions is redistricting. And as you know, every 10 years with the census, the city evaluates its current council districts and the population within each one, and make sure that they are correctly balanced and that they pass muster under the Voting Rights Act. So now we have the results of the census in, and we have a consultant who's already looking at the numbers. And at this point, we can ask the consultant to prepare draft maps for 6 versus 7, so you have that information to go on. Once the consultant prepares these potential districts, and this is also doesn't have to happen within any particular time. The ultimate decision just needs to, on redistricting, just needs to be reached more than 6 months in front of the 2025 election. So there is time. But then after the consultant prepares his analysis and recommendation, you move into a series of public input meetings, and then during this time, the city can make that decision on whether to transition to the council manager form of government. And then ultimately, the city can adopt new district boundary lines for either 6 or 7 districts, depending on the outcome. And then 2025 would be the first election with the new city council district boundary lines.
Just for clarification, we have to do this no matter what we
decision.
Yes. It must be done to balance our district.
Yes. The process would just change depending on if the council was going down a district. If the residents decide to change to the council manager form of government. Yes. then finally, I'd like to know that if the city does make the change to the council manager form of government, there would be a lot of preparation time that would be needed within City Hall to help everybody learn the new roles and who reports to who, go through the city manager hiring process, you know, talk through how the mayor and city manager will interact. You know, this question came up at the council meeting, but there's nothing in the act that says the mayor has to be a full-time employee, so that's something that could be evaluated. Of course, we would want to do a lot of public outreach and education, because we learned from cities throughout this process that they still have to go through all of that outreach and education, even if they've had a city manager for a long time, just so people know who to get in touch with, whether it's their council member, whether it's the city manager or the mayor, to get in touch with the right person for the question that they have or the issue that they would like to see resolved. Also, the city would need to reevaluate provisions in its city code that gives the mayor administrative duties, for example, provisions in the code that provide for board and committee appointments that are tied to council districts, and look at job descriptions and who reports to who. So those are some of the things that the city would need to look at, and it would take time. So we just wanted to let you all know that that would be a part of the to-do list for making this change. And that's all I have for this meeting. I'd be glad to take your questions. I've already got a little list going of questions we've heard this evening, and so I'll be glad to add any others to the list and do a little research and then follow up with you by email or at another work session.
What's the timeline that you're thinking for starting? I guess it's going to be the position.
Well, I think maybe a couple of things. One, you know, let you guys digest this, take some time to talk through it. At some point, this is something you want to do, which is one, both, and neither, which then would be kind of to, okay, we also want to get community feedback. And the best way that we did that with the schools, when we look at the property tax, was to go out into the community for some community meetings where we can basically present what we just presented here and obtain some feedback. So probably that's what we would look to do, get an idea of what the community and the council feels, and then try to make good decisions from there. So I don't have a time frame on it, but it's not tomorrow.
Right.
Once we,
I'll do this quickly because 3 minutes is not enough.
Are you asking me to move that?
We basically had something like this happen back in the early 80s when we had a recall. Back then, cities could have recall at high recall. I think it was the last one in the state that stopped that. And in the recall election, before we had a recall, we were a commission form of government. They weren't for three. But unbeknownst to the citizens, they hired the city manager. I don't think we voted on it. I'm not positive about that. I don't remember. And that's a long time ago. Got a little brain fog also. But I can't remember everything. But we had the recall. And, I mean, this city manager took over everything. I don't think the mayor didn't want to have anything to do with it. And the city manager was not a very good person. We finally decided we had to have so many people sign a petition, just like this we're going to do here. A certain percent of the people that voted in the last election. Now, we're talking about a population of about 300,000 or 400,000. We're not talking about 55,000. So, but we had plenty of people on that petition, a lot more than what they needed. The city manager resigned, the mayor resigned, and I think one of the commissioners resigned. We did have an election, but the city manager was not the kind of person you wanted. It's like you're talking about. You know, with leadership and management. I don't think the city even voted on this. But it was the last recall that the city had, and that's how I got this. It's because of that recall election. That is bad. About 883, something like that. But, and the old stay 5 more years after that. But a lot of the problems that happened caused that recall was the city manager. Just want you to know, be careful.
Yes, ma'am.
Not supposed to talk.
At the committee, I know it's what seats are, I don't know.
Who is the longest, who is the only Madison longest?
We found various, some of us are long term.
How long?
We all range probably from 5 to 25 years. Yes, ma'am.
A lot of us have been through a lot of different things in movement and growth in Madison, so we've seen it. And then just to comment back on your question, that's why it's very, we were very specific to ask the qualifications and what to look for in a good city manager. You know, we were very, it was very important for us to do all the research to make sure we had the answers to all your questions. We didn't want to leave anything out. Exactly. And it is important for the citizens to vote on this because they're going to be working. So, yes.
And again, we'll get all this added to the website tomorrow.
There's a lot more information around table board meetings and all that stuff too.
How confident are you on the fact that what we found all the conflicts
things are at. Because I know we're running that issue in Hill Chase, and they're going to try to put locates, kind of hard to put locates in the PDC versus cast iron.
On this one versus Hughes, why don't we have the same problem with utility conflicts on this that we did on Hughes? The second one is, I don't want to answer this one, is if we go forward, one of the things, you know, if we can we do utility conflicts on the front next time?
Yes.
What happened, we got this started and then it stopped. I mean, if we had never started it, nobody would really care. And then all of a sudden we're jet fueling it through. And can we do a collective better job as a city and all of us to not have something like that happen next time?
coming to a big project?
Yes, and I think Michelle would good. Not want to do another project unless you did that.
Good.
Perfect. That one makes sure you like it.
Come on, you know, is that even possible?
Good. Well, I want to make sure we support that.
We're trying to keep her sane. It's just, it's very hard.
We'll do our best to help Michelle. All right. Well, I think we can do a better job of funding on our end if
we will. I think we can. So, Short Street, we've got the utility relocation completed. There's a base down. We've got one remaining conflict, and that is at the north end of Short Street. We've got to put in a retaining wall next to the antique annex. And there's an electric line that got put in, and we just have a limited amount of room. So, we have utilities, utilities. We're trying to determine if we can not get into all the details, but we've got some ideas about how we can resolve this conflict. And so, once we get that fixed and or resolved, and once the utility buys off on the solution, then the paving can begin. We're expecting to have a start. And we're fairly close, we think, to coming up with some kind of resolution. Our backup plan, and we don't have a physical solution in the ground, is to try and push once utilities to agree to allow us to put the wall where we want to put the wall. They've got a line underneath it, and they don't like the idea of having a wall on top of their line, because if they have to remove the wall, they think that somehow we're going to make them put the wall back in. And so we'll have council approve an agreement saying we'll take responsibility for the wall. And they're still just uneasy with that, but if push comes to shove, we might have to resort to that. But we're trying to fix, come up with a physical solution on the ground to not have, to force them in. So we're hoping that paving would begin again next month in February, and then we have everything completed in the spring. Schultz Electric does the lighting, and you know, talking with Michelle through this, it's possible that may trail just depending upon their scheduling. But if we get the road completed, that would be great. Most of the sidewalk is in now, actually, and you can get through there at least now. Some work to do, but we're hopeful to wrap this one up. And the contractor had said they've got about 5 weeks of work to do once we give them the green light on the wall. So we'll see if that happens. And I should say, at the beginning of this, all of our schedules, of course, are weather dependent. And you know, coming into a sketchy time in terms of rain and so forth. Shorter Street Drainage is a small project that we are doing, and it needs to be completed before we can do a road project in this area. Must utilities have a transmission pole that they have to move. They're supposed to be doing that this week. And once that's completed, then our contractor can complete a junction box, and they have to cover the remainder of the exposed pipe. This should all be completed in February. We've been waiting for Huntsville Utilities to get the pole relocated for a couple of months now, and so we're trying to get it there. So that project has to be completed in order for this project to be completed. These are the street improvements that are related to the middle school going forward. We've had some good conversations with the school district's engineer and architect recently. Finally got their contractor to move their stuff out of the roadway that we have to approve. That happened on the 17th. Our contractor is finally starting work. We, as you might recall, you know, our goal was to get all of this improvement completed by July in anticipation of the school year starting. That's not going to be achievable for the entire roadway. But what we're talking about with the contractor and the schedule that they're working on is so that that northern piece that would serve the parking lot for the school will be completed in July. That all said, you know, in talking with their team, their architects and so forth, they don't need this to be completed for the school to open and function because they can rely on Celtech, but it would certainly And so our contractor understands that, and so we're pushing them on it. They gave us a schedule.
out there to see what they want to like when they started. So we'll be pushing them hard. Any questions on this one?
He was just asking about the extension that would eventually happen.
Yeah.
Instead of going to life where you keep going on.
Right, and that hasn't been designed or funded yet. Ultra Whitening is an LDOT project. This was supposed to start in August of this year. They moved it out of the year to not start until August of 2023. They did finally approve our environmental document in September. That took them a little under a year to approve the environmental document. Michelle's identified that additional funding is going to be required to complete this project. One of the LDOT's comments is they were uncomfortable with an area of the design in terms of proximity of structure. So we've got to require just a little bit of right of way, not a whole lot, but we will have to do that to accommodate for the plan. I guess all along we've known that there's a gas line that's going to have to be relocated. We've got some options with that. We could just pay it outright, or we could add it to the LDOT MPO list, and then the gas company can apply for funds for that. So we have to figure out which way we want to go on that. And then our standard thing is to, we've been hiring consultants to prepare the data, and we want to hire somebody to do construction engineering and inspection. All of these costs have come in easily close to $500,000, depending upon routes we go and how complicated complex they are. It is an LDOT product, so it does add some costs. We've got some time to figure this out when we start, and obviously we've got other priorities in terms of getting Hughes going and finishing some and getting Barnes going, and we'll devote some brain power to troubleshooting this.
How much is this going to be widened from like just north of Mill to just south of the hospital, not starting at West, either closer to Mill or between like Mill and Browns Ferry for all? Oh, it is? And is that separate from this? Is that similar to this? Because this says it's starting at the lesser.
It's an error on my part on that.
Oh, okay. So
it goes from basically down to Browns Ferry.
Yes.
Okay,
that makes me feel a lot
better. Thank you. Okay, I want to mention a citizen had reached out and was concerned about the Bulge Ridge intersection. And because we've got the hill sight distance and people are starting to increase speeds. And so this was raised to us a number of months ago. And so our engineering staff took a look at it in terms of whether some kind of improvement in notification to the risk was warranted. And back with the county, and where we are on that is there is an agreement that we need to put in some stop signs and some warning. So the county will go ahead and install it in, so that the northern part of the intersection is unincorporated, the southern side of that intersection is city of Madison. So the county will go ahead and put in mirror controls. We're going to put in ours. We need to put in an electric sign, I guess I'll call it. So Public Works has finally gotten a quote from an electrician to do that. I'm going to get with council utilities. There's a lot of steps involved. It seems like it would be simple. But I did want to say that if you get any inquiries, we are working on trying to improve signage and information for motorists.
When you say stop signs, are you looking at like a three-way stop, or are you looking at putting a sign similar to that attention road that warns people you're kind of
moving forward, forward stuff at the intersection? But there's also going to be the electric sign like one I mentioned. Right. Would be further south on Box to warn people as they come over that hill that there's a car out there.
So before you get to the intersection of Gooch.
So where are you going to put a four-way
at the church?
Stop.
It goes up to the church.
Oh, wow, okay.
Also, that's about time. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Because they're not Gooch.
No, Gooch. If you go across Gulch.
Yes.
On Gooch, it's the church driveway. It's straight across.
So what about the actual intersection of Gooch and Gulch? Is that where you would put a sign similar to Pension Road to warn people they're coming on that hill?
That's the four-way stop. And Gooch and Gulch is where the church is.
I mean, there's only three. You just go north, south, and then you get into a house.
No, it's a lane.
At Gooch and Gulch?
It goes into the church.
There's the guy's house just south of the church.
Yes. But the driveway for the church is here, and the guy's driveway is here.
Okay.
I mean, they're 2 feet apart, maybe.
What do you think? Because you have the same thought. I'm thinking you're thinking what I'm thinking, which is
My first question is on this one when it came to Gulch. And the additional funding, didn't we agree with all that on a certain number to take care of this project? I'll go back, Steve and I need to work on that, so I think I'll make that. We need to do that. We had it defined, we paid this, and that's it.
Right.
And so now all of a sudden it's changing. And
yep. Michelle and I discussed that today. This is something that we're going to have to do. This is essentially a restriping project to support town Madison. This is a project to build out. We're supposed to work project in February. We're expecting construction to start about April. Seeing the rain, the project work should be considered complete by late summer. This is going to be including access into and out. Project for Madison Boulevard. This is from the county line to basically the east city limits, although a couple of pieces have already been done in the direction to Westchester and then right around Zero Road. So this is a fairly large project. This is through LDOT as well. We would hope that construction would start first quarter of 2023. A couple of traffic signals, three actually on Madison Boulevard, just new signals that go up Production Avenue, and then the modifying signaling in a driveway. The pre-construction meeting scheduled for next week, and then we would expect the meeting to be sometime this year. And the county line will be the signal part of the same
you
guys approved those. The pre-construction meeting is going to be next week, and once we have that, we'll understand from the contractor what they think, when they think they'll get the poles. That's what they do. Time poles would be like 6 months to get a pole for a traffic signal. Now, in County Line and Hardin, we have the poles, right? That's just pretty wide.
That's just wide.
Yeah. So when we have the pre-construction meeting next week, we'll have a talk schedule with the contractors and kind of set up the time. In terms of intersection improvements, we have two intersection improvements that we're working on in relationship to supporting middle school going in. So some of that's being done by a contractor, some of that's being done by Public Works. So we've got the signal plans in for review for Will Halsey Beach Road, and for Madison Boulevard, it was Sullivan. The design is about 60% complete. We could expect both of these to be complete this summer sometime. So this is
did the line for providing paving, although Husky Utilities still has to install the streetlights. We paid Husky Utilities to install the streetlights, but they haven't been installed yet. Intergraph is restriping for permanent parking. Cedars Bower is the same thing. Baltimore City Roundabout was just the final payment closeout. Westchester is also striping, and then Madison Boulevard is also striping. And then Harden Road is completed with its final striping plan. This is a list of projects that are in design phase right now. The extension of Sunset Boulevard that we talked about before, doing some rehabilitation on Mill Road. There's also a drainage ditch on Dean and Martin that we were required to do. This was an agreement required right away. Property owner, some bridge repair, bridge replacement on Palmer Road, and then a raspberry crossing. So they're in various stages. In most cases, you see we approve design contracts with consultants to work on those plans. So that wraps it up for, I'll say, the Pure Road project. So the next few slides are just on our recreation-related pilots. We've got Open Spring Branch on phase one. Public Works to pay that. We expect that will be done in the summer when it's dry. We've got everything else done, and so that will be on the east side of the Great North, starting at Stillwater Cove, and on the north side solution. Lime Quarry, there is a multi-use path that we're building on the south side, or excuse me, the north side of that road, and Public Works will also be doing that, and that will be installed this year. And this is one, as you'll recall, through the development agreement, we got money from the developer that's building projects here to support that. Palmer Park, we're waiting for Hudson Utilities to connect power to the site, and recreation is expected for the field to be used this spring. And the trailhead is also waiting on power and with the same time frame. Spring. Home Place Park, the park and the stage component are essentially complete. But you'll recall that we're doing the picnic pavilion, so the steel is up. We drive by there, we got that finished for the most part. The roofing is going to start next week, and that'll take a couple of weeks to finish. And then we've got a drainage punch list item. Then I'm still working on figuring out how we're going to take care of that. I think we will have a big draft up in March. Recreation used the park for an event in December, using the stage and so forth. The other thing that we've got trash cans and benches, they're just waiting to be installed. They're at Public Works Yard, and those will be installed once our contractors on the property. And then we still need to order some seating for the pavilion. We haven't ordered that yet. And then lastly, we have the community center, which is currently in the design phase for phase one, which would be the buildings and just the adjacent courtyards. It doesn't include any of the other property land on the other side of our facility, et cetera. And preparations is going to put that out, the phase one has been.
Yes. Do we know when the design will begin on the Brownsberry Burger and Roundup?
Brownsberry and Burger we have not had a conversation about that. I guess my preference would be we are so overloaded right now trying to troubleshoot pre-existing projects that I would be resistant to trying to take on a new project right now. We just can't. We just don't have enough staff to do that properly. I mean, and even if we hire a consultant, it takes time to get a contract, to manage the consultant, to review the consultant's work plans, and I don't even know what the funding of it. So
there? And what are we talking about?
I think that's something that we can figure out. We could certainly talk about it, and I think you would be by planning on having a college strategy session on future projects, right? So we can certainly.
It's within a year and a half.
Yeah, we can certainly be prepared.
I was too.
We can certainly be prepared. We can be prepared for that session in March to kind of talk to you about what we think might be realistic. And then, you know, obviously we have a goal that, you know, we want to be able to support it, but we really need to get these other projects
taken care of. But just put it on your radar, there's 600 apartments being built at that intersection in town, and it's going to put us even further behind any law.
I understand.
Also, could council please get a complete list of everything that's on the CIP?
Sure, I thought that you all provided a resolution, and I thought that
even the ones that are not officially approved but are planned, can we know what's in the pipeline?
Well, what I just reviewed, or you know, what Michelle and I put together, is everything that we are working on right now in terms of items that you have authorized either to be constructed or to be designed. There, you know, there's certainly a list of projects that either, you know, council, current council, staff has identified of, you know, that we would like to take on. And part of what we do in each budget cycle, right, is to evaluate, you know, what do we have funding for and what's the immediate need. And then periodically we'll have, you know, CIP strategy sessions where we kind of talk about that list. And so my understanding was that in March, is it, that you all were going to be, you know, having that conversation, and that what we were supposed to be doing as staff is kind of assembling that list, the inputs that have been previously provided to the mayor's office, calling our list and what we understand the needs, and pulling that all together for you to have a conversation in March. So that's what we were planning on doing. Is that meeting your expectation?
Well, I mean, there's got to be a current list that you have.
And well, the current list that we're working is what we just reviewed with you. There are projects that engineering the last budget cycle, there are projects that they identified that we didn't have funding for. And so those are kind of waiting in the wings. And so, you know, for this upcoming strategy session and for the next budget cycle, that's when, you know, staff will say, this is our recommendation, right? You've got X million dollars, this is where we think you put that money. And usually there's not enough funds for all of the projects, and so you have to, you know, evaluate those and make those decisions. But we do have a list of gee, it would be really good to do these, or these are really critical, you know. And so we have that kind of information that's put together.
Like on the website, it's like from 2018 is what's out there. If I go and search on the website for the CIP, it's very outdated. So we've got to have something that y'all are working on that's more current than 2018.
So the 2018 exercise is because we're going to have to put on market. And so you're going to have a certain amount of bond funds to work with. And so we went through a fairly detailed exercise as staff and then ultimately the council to approve. And that's how those projects were crafted. We have not gone out to the bond market since 2018 or 2018. Or CIP projects in general. So we have gone through and done and exhausted, I would say, an exercise like that. The huge road project, the Sullivan Road project, those are all projects from that 2018 exercise, and we're obviously working to try and get those done. So these big projects take a lot of time for various reasons.
We'll take the current list, and if Steve and I will scrub the budget that was put in place, and if there's things things that are missing from the list that Mary Beth just said, that we add to that, we'll be able to, that are in our budget this year, that aren't on this list, we'll get that to you along with what's already in place. We got it.
Can I ask about the Hughes or Madison playgrounds area in section? We had talked in previous council about fixing that and getting that property on the general side.
That would be a future discussion in March.
Okay.
And that's one of, economies, that's one of the projects we have on our list that we haven't been able to fund yet. Our own lot.
And then, two things, the paving piece that we funded or approved Monday night, all the paving now can't start taking and putting in there, the tiling and Mahan and Miller being the first one, neighborhood, all the other neighborhood paving that goes along with that. So that one is going to start, and we'll start to make sure that we get that out. Obviously, that's weather dependent and getting folks going. The only other one that I, this may not be on there, it may not be a project, but did we agree to restripe Waltrana? But that was in our budget and all the way up. Yeah, so that's just one we still just have to get to.
We've asked for a quote, we're waiting to get that back and then line up for the striker.
Okay, so something like that that we just make sure we add to the list if we're missing it, because they're just, again, I love Karen the other day when you said that. I really want to get community feedback on these two projects, but they're not even close to being discussed yet.
Yeah,
and so what's happening is they're killing her with emails with people. I don't want it, I don't want it, I don't want it. It's like, we don't need it right now. There's no one, we're not ready to talk about it. So,
yeah,
we'll be assigned for it.
And then once they sign that it's budgeted, they're like, oh my gosh, it's coming and nobody's talked to us about it. That's what I don't know. So, once the neighbors found out about it, they haven't, and they don't. So, and then, I mean, the public hearing, they're broke. So, if you give them a chance, and they can see how their concerns are being addressed. I don't know,
All I can do is hold it on. So that's how I'm going to do it. We'll scrub the list for you, take that plus what we cut in the budget, and just make sure if there's anything else in there we can get
to. I think that will help us better answer our citizens' questions when it comes to us and say, well, where is this? And they ask about Burger and Brown Carriage. And say, well, it's supposed to be being designed sometime this year. And they said, you don't have any idea closer than a year. And I said, no, and I don't even know if it's going to happen this year. And that is not satisfying.
Well, the fact that I understand, I'm not here.
Last council, is we all came over the projects just like we have, right? And we sent that staff had it. We had a list, and then the time was Paul and Taylor, and they worked that list and put it in there. And then the session we're talking about March is when we get in there, right? And it's number 1 through 10, right? That's most important. By the matrix is done. And then we discuss that, and that's where those projects came out. Okay, and we did that. I think we had 5 projects. There were 10 total, 5 that we got to do. And then out of that 5, one of them was bigger dollar cost, and it put some other ones down the list. So that might be some of the ones we're seeing, and those will be the ones that will have to be picked up on the next bond issue.
I understand. It's just that I don't remember we have seen the three of us on the council that complete list.
Because it's not complete, because there's those old projects that are on there, plus the new projects that each of us have pushed in, right? And staff is still working the old projects trying to get done most, and they're short staff.
Yeah, and part of it's just that other than your regular budget cycle, right, we're not going out to the bond market. We're not expecting to go out anytime soon. So it's not like we know we've got an infusion of funding coming up, and it makes sense to say, oh, yeah, let's sort of talk about these 20 projects. And so, normally, CIP, you're funding it, right, on an annual basis. And so
done on an annual basis. It's just periodically, if we're going out to the bond market, we have an opportunity to, you know, look at a bigger pool. And we just haven't had to do that. We haven't had the opportunity to do that because we're not going out to the bond market. So that's why, why you're not seeing some big.
That's okay. I mean, Paul, yeah. What Paul said is good.
We'll stop here because one of the things that was in, I think, Steve tried to do with what was happening was maybe we can engineer it this year and start the process. Once we kind of engineer it, then we can have a better idea what it's going to cost and we can look to possibly fund it next year. The Bird Rain Browns Ferry roundabout was one, I think, that was in there that said we'll try to engineer it this year. We don't need to get to it yet because to engineer it. We have to sit down with Michelle and Mary Beth and anybody else to sit down. Even if we contract that out, there has to be discussion with our folks right now. So everything's getting pushed a little bit to the left, but we need to get you that list and that data. This is the great first step. We'll have a second step to make sure that that is provided. And anything else that wasn't on here, we'll update that also.
Is there an update on the department head review?
No, just go hug Michelle when you leave.
Oh, I know.
We appreciate it.
Yeah. Having one harder there.
Any other questions from Ms. Zephyr? If not, I think Megan and Chief of the Youngs, yeah, you think they will talk about it.
Chief of the Youngs.
So what it does is it allows the officers more discretion than what they have right now. As it stands right now, it's very restrictive. The officer has to tow the car, regardless of whether you have a licensed driver sitting next to the driver. The way the code reads, if you catch the driver without a license, or the driver with a suspended license, we have to tow the car. Well, that's now incurring an extra expense on the driver. A lot of people